This class yesterday is helpful for numbers 1 and 2.
It's not imaginary, but it is irrational, exactly what you said.
Problems, you're actually solving these equations.
Yeah, 2 fourth-degree polynomials you're going to solve, you're going to find answers for. And a third degree you're going to solve and find answers for, and a fourth degree.
Second degree.
Actually solving.
Wait, so have we learned this before,
Miss? Yeah, 8 times C method. I reviewed it in the class yesterday.
Yeah. It's in every chapter of the book. It's in all the content.
So, Max, what multiplies the 12 but adds to negative 8? You can do that. Yeah, negative 6 times negative 2 is a positive 12. And negative 6 minus 2 is negative 8. With the 8 times C method, after you find those numbers, you put them in the middle. So we're going to put these numbers in the middle. I'm keeping the first term the same to the fourth degree. And in the middle, I'm rewriting 8x squared as a 6 and a 2. Okay? And then we factor like by grouping, just like we did in chapter 4, looking at each group of 2. I look for a GCS. These both are divisible by 2, and they both have an x squared. And when you factor a 2 out, it's like dividing, we end up with 2 squared minus 3. Question so far? Taking the greatest common factor of 2 and x squared here. One of the criteria for factor by grouping is that the parentheses match. And we talked about if this third term is negative, you should factor out a negative 1. And that changes those signs so that these parentheses are matching. So our final answer would be 2 squared minus 3, the matching set. And then bring the GCS together. So this is now the factored form. As you saw in last night's homework, if you did them, not all polynomials can be factored. So solving them requires some different skills. But if it can be factored, factor it and then solve the factor. So with quadratics, we would just take these and make little mini equations. We're doing that again here. So solve these little mini equations.
Thank you.
these are the only thing that have to be the same. Is that what you mean? So we solve by square rooting. And it's really important to remember the plus or minus signs. This is a fourth degree polynomial. So it has four roots. And I do see four answers here. There's the positive square root of 3 over 2 and the negative square root of 3 over 2. The positive square root of 1 half and the negative square root of 1 half. I want to go ahead and get decimals for these. So I want you to put these in your calculator and tell me what all four of these decimals are. The square root of 3 over 2. You have a calculator?
I'll give it to you guys in groups. Then your calculator is square root of 2. Let's go to the thousand.
That's three decimal places. The square root of 1.5 and the square root of 0.5 is what you're doing. What else? So we're going to have then, okay. So that'll be positive and negative.
So say it one more time, 1.2247.
So I rounded this number. I don't then round again. No. Just round the last one again.
Okay.
Did anybody else get this number when they square rooted 0.5?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, because what I know, I'm gonna pull up decimals and I'm gonna graph that and we're gonna see if y'all tell me where are these points gonna show up in the graph? What are these answers?
They're minima and maximum.
What are these? So these are x-intercepts that we just found. So now if we had to make a table and graph, we know we could do like negative 2 through positive 2. And that would give us a nice picture of the graph.
Was that really fun video I showed earlier?
Alright, so here's the graph. You know, I questioned if today we should graph this by hand or if I should just show you this. And graphing takes such a long time that I decided just to show it to you. So, the purpose of factoring is pretty valuable because it's giving us these x-intercepts. So 1.2 right here, and negative 1.2 right here, 0.7 right here, negative 0.7 and positive 0.7. In here you can see clear your y-intercept. Okay, so if you're asked to solve, factoring gave you the four solutions to this four-tick polynomial, and if you're asked to graph, it gave you the four zeros or the intercepts. Okay? All right, and the next one, same method. Did you take a GCF out? Number two, before I start A times C method, I'm going to divide everything by 2 because all of those numbers can be divided by 2. So this is what you're actually factoring. So I'm going to wait for you guys. I'm going to give you some time in your groups to try to factor that using that A times C method. This is just number 2. You guys could call this classwork or bellwork.
Wait, so did you already simplify it or move down?
Yeah, I took it 2 out. As the greatest common factor, now you're doing 8 times 2 out. Why did you take it 2 out? Because if you can take a GCF out, you should make it easier. Your best strategy always is. This 3-term problem could not be factored, so we got creative and rewrote 5.
Why couldn't it be factored?
As 8 minus 3.
How big
are you? Well, you can't find numbers that multiply. This is how you break it down into 2 sets of parentheses that can be solved. You're learning to rewrite expression in a different way so that it can be solved equivalently. And this is just the tricks of rewriting. If there was another way to think about it and talk about it and rewrite it, you could. This is the only way people have figured out to rewrite this and to teach it.
Procedurally.
You could. You'll get the same answer.
Yeah.
Right, there's your factored form. It doesn't matter which one you wrote first. Factor both equations. I mean, solve both equations. So this one came out imaginary, huh? If you just don't put the negative in your factor, you bring the I out and just square it too. It's imaginary.
Yeah, so would it be, you get a decimal, would it be an imaginary?
Correct. So this is a root, but it's not an intercept, because if it's an imaginary, it's not crossing the real x-axis. So this graph is going to look more like this, where the second hump doesn't cross.
Oh,
where
that's why it's imaginary.
Because
so
these are imaginary.
So why is it even a number?
So there's a complex coordinate plane. The imaginary numbers are used in real electrical engineering. So this number is used mostly in electronics. I don't know how to do this. And why are we bringing back imaginary numbers?
Why are we bringing back the I?
You guys, you'll never ever again, unless you go back to Algebra 1, not bring back imaginary numbers. It's a standard that you learned. And you'll never ever again not have to do the 8 times C method. Which I have told you for months. Okay? Well, factoring 8 times C method at times, you're going to square root a negative and have an imaginary answer. But listen, don't argue with it. Actually, understand what it looks like. Imaginary roots don't reach the x-axis. That's valuable. So that's fun.
If we have spare time at some point, can we go back over
imaginary numbers? I'll tell you right now. Awesome. If you got a square root and there's a negative sign, you write an I outside.
On the outside, not on the inside.
And why can't we put the negative?
Because when mathematicians decided we're going to show the difference between square rooting a positive and a negative, it means you did a negative. You put a negative out here. Your calculator won't square root a negative sign. So if you put an I out front, you can now square root this in your calculator. Okay. That's it. That's all the time it is.
Why don't we just put a negative?
So,
like, why
the I? A negative number is not the same as an imaginary number.
You don't get it.
You said at this point, if you didn't understand it before, stop arguing and just look at it and try to get the steps down. There's no point arguing it. You're not going to, like, all of a sudden be like, oh, everybody's position for special has no sense. Because, hey, we figured out that negative shouldn't show up that way. That's not going to happen. Just learn the steps. Just flow into it.
Alright, next. You guys, this one's cubic. Who in here can recall yesterday the pattern for cubes?
These are the answers right here. If we were going to compare it to a graph, I would say put some decimals down. That's fine. But we can leave it here. I'm not trying to make the graph.
I square root of the bottom, because it's always better. Like 4 square root of 2. Oh yeah, for number 3 it's a 4, yeah. Good job. Okay? Some people in here are, so be quiet while they do. Like honestly, stop. Just stop. Okay?
Actually, how many roots period? Because these are imaginary.
Oh my goodness.
So the degree is the possible root period.
She just looked at me.
So. All right, these first two are the ones I'm most interested in.